Hi. Today we're going to talk about the database LogWriter and the impact on OLTP response times, and also the impact it tends to happen on the effect of a total system associated with going through middleware layers, and just show you some examples of what can happen in a real-world system, and we do see in real-world systems, but are very rarely correctly diagnosed. And it's important that you do actually look at these things, because a lot of variability in your response time may be an impact of just basically the LogWriter not being able to perform correctly. So let's think about how the Oracle database is structured and what the LogWriter does. Well, the LogWriter's role is to basically write commit records and write enough information to recover transactions. This is done by the redo log. And there's just one process that does this, and it's called the LogWriter. And when a user process wants to commit, it posts the LogWriter to write away the redo information associated with the transaction and a commit record. With that in mind, it means that the user process is often in a wait state, waiting for the LogWriter to do that write. The LogWriter will do that write as fast as possible, and whilst that's going on, the user process is in a state and a wait event known as log file sync. Now, many people say that log file sync is their most common wait event, and they try and fix the log file sync wait event rather than looking at the root cause of the problem. And usually the problem is one of two folds. There's two reasons why they're in log file sync. One is that the log writer is taking a long time to write the log to disk. And the second thing is if the log writer has to wake up a lot of processes having done the log write, you may find that you're waking up more processes than there are CPUs on the system, in which case we get into an oversubscription case, which we've demonstrated in other real-world videos. So with that in mind, I'd like you to look at a system that has got some pathological logging problems. And let's look at the demo screen that we have here. You'll notice that we've got almost this square-shaped wave, and this is not an accident. We've manufactured this for you. And what's happening is we're running a workload, and at a point of time, the workload is running just fine. And then at a point in time, the workload almost falls down to zero. What you also notice in the application performance, when the response time gets high, is correlated with the time where the throughput drops. Now, what I really wanted to show to you is what we can see in the red. The red is the database response time increasing, and that's as a result of we're seeing high log file syncs. But what I'd like to show you, see, is what's happening in the application server. We're getting this multiplication or amplification effect, that a small increase in response time at the database gets multiplied through the app server. So being at the bottom of the stack, like the LogWriter is, if it basically gets a slow IO write or struggles to get scheduled, there's a fair chance that any response time changes or degradations or deltas at the bottom of the stack, by the time you've got out to the web browser, this will have been multiplied through. And this is because we have just a series of loosely coupled systems queuing requests at all layers of the application, all waiting for something to happen. Now, if the thing at the bottom is delayed, everybody gets delayed. And so this is why we get this amplification effect. And this is seen very often in real-world systems where we have shared storage, where the storage is being shared amongst multiple databases. In fact, maybe shared between database applications, it may be shared amongst Microsoft Exchange servers, it may be other applications that are logging data, it may be a file system. Because today, the reality is that in many large corporations, storage is just seen as a space to store things. It is administered by storage administrators who do their allocations on the basis of space. They allocate space for a database, or they allocate space for log files, and they're allocating space. They very rarely make the decisions on the basis of performance. So let's have a look and see what happens when the impact is when we share storage, particularly when we share the storage associated with our redo log files. So in this workload where we're getting this square-shaped workload, you can see that when there's a performance problem in CPM, we're all stuck in log file sync. It also teaches us another important lesson, that if we actually start looking at the log writer statistics, that the log file sync, the time spent in log file sync, is usually the time spent on a log file write times the number of users on the system. So here you can see of a millisecond, we have approximately 100, or in fact 96, so 100 connections, just over 100 connections to the database. And you can see that approximately the log file sync is approximately 100 times that we have on the log file write. In terms, as we get into the situation where the log file write becomes more variable, and in fact we've got log writes that are taking more than a second, you can see that this tends to get multiplied through. However, the thing to also note about this system, that the log file write statistical average is really good. It's under a millisecond. But we know we've still got a system in trouble. So the statistical average times for log file sync and write times are very good. And this is another thing to be wary of if you read your AWR reports, that you may have a race condition or something going on in that hour report that the AWR report were pertaining, but it may be you may have a statistical outlier that happens for 5 minutes out of that hour, but that will all get rounded down by the averaging process when you look at an AWR report. So it's important to get up on Enterprise Manager and look at ASH reports and look at the spikes. Now in this workload that we've got here, we've artificially made the log writer slow by having another database continually checkpoint and do a lot of I/O to the same disks that we write redo to. As a result, the log writes are getting slower and slower. And in fact, some of the log writes, as you can see, we've got 10 of them over a second. So whilst I've been running 10 of the seconds, the database has been effectively stalled. Now, on a high volume OLTP system, this is pretty much as close to an outage as you're going to get. Now, let's think about what actually happens in real world systems on shared storage. Basically, the storage administrator will have given the DBA a series of LUNs, not based on the performance requirements, but based on disk space. Now, those LUNs may be sharing disks with all sorts of other applications. Now, those applications may checkpoint from time to time. They may be dumping, writing a load of log files. They may be periodically. So very often we see on real world systems at the top of the hour when people are running reports or checkpoints and things like that, the log writer slows down. This is because literally the log writer slows down because the writes are slowed down. And we see higher log file sync at the top of the hour because the writes have slowed down. And this is exactly what we're seeing here. This is not a good way to run an OLTP system, but it's something what we see a lot of. Now, to actually solve this problem, there's multiple ways to solve it. Some we would not recommend, some are inevitable ways to solve the problem. One of the first ways we can actually solve the problem, and this is not something we would recommend, is to not actually synchronize with your commit and do an asynchronous commit. We see a lot of people doing this in benchmarks and POCs because they want to raise the throughput level. But when we start doing asynchronous commits, it means that we tell the application we've committed, but there's no guarantee that we will have actually committed the log. So you'll notice I've just put in asynchronous committing, and you can see that we can't even trust log file sync or the log file parallel write because it doesn't actually mean anything to us at this point in time, because the user processes are not weighted on log file sync. They're just going to write the commit record into the redo buffer and then just hope the log writer catches up. And as a result, you can see on this trace, there are no log file sync wait events because nobody's waiting on it. We're keeping the CPU busy. Now, in a minute, what we're going to do is we're going to see the I/O storm created by the other database. So it still actually starts to slow the workload down. But the reason it starts to slow down now at this point in time is that we're actually seeing the redo log buffer filling up, okay? And so we're backing up on the redo buffer, log buffer space, okay? So it's not exactly solved the problem at this point in time, but it certainly made it less bad than it was before. But potentially, we're affecting the transactional integrity of the application. Other solutions would be to just put the redo logs on their own dedicated disks. Now, my experience when asking this from storage administrators is usually one of ridicule and being laughed out of the room. You say, you want me to allocate specific disk drives for you? And they're not really very keen on doing that. In fact, it's got so ludicrous within our industry, in many cases the DBAs can raise a PO to get dedicated storage for the redo logs quicker than they can get the storage administrators to give them dedicated storage. So in many cases, we find that the DBA teams are raising POs for flash devices and solid state devices to put their redo logs on. And then they say, oh, all our performance problems went away because we got flash devices. And he goes, no, you didn't get it because it was flash devices. It's because it was exclusively your device. You never had to share it. Okay? Flash devices are fast, but in many cases, they're not the reason why things went on. It was because they could get predictable write performance from their log writer. And that was the key to the performance. And as you can see, you know, asynchronous techniques are not working here. So let's turn off the asynchronous commit, and let's talk about other options within Oracle to get fast log times. Now, one of the challenges is, and the reasons why storage administrators don't like to give exclusive storage to redo logs is that they're very often incentivized about maximizing utilization of all the disks and getting the space filled optimally. Okay, and because that impacts their cost of storage and the cost of operations. We have the same concept also within Exadata, where people are actually using the Exadata storage for both logging and database files, and they're sharing and striping everything across all the volumes and all the cells. And within Exadata, we can actually manifest this same problem. But within Exadata, we've been able to innovate a way around the problem, because Exadata storage has both disk drives, but it also has flash devices inside it. So the way Exadata solves the problem of erratic log performance is to write to both the log disk as well as the flash device at the same time and take the write back from the one that comes back first. So if we think about that, we basically get the best of both worlds. If the log write to disk is fast, we come back quickly. If, however, it's an outlier because the disk is so busy, the write to flash memory, it'll return suitably quickly as well. So let's apply flash logging to this workload and see what the impact on performance is. You can see that we've gone back and we're back in the erratic state. So let's turn flash logging on. I'm going to apply it now and turn that on. And what I'm also going to do is I'm going to clear down some statistics so I can find a number. Okay, so I've now turned on flash logging, and I've zeroed out all the statistics that we had on the right-hand side here. And what the first thing to notice is we're not seeing, when the I/O storms come in, we're not seeing the outliers in the write times. So let's wait for the next I/O storm to come along and see what happens. You'll notice that basically the log write time is now just over a quarter of a millisecond, and the log file sync time is under a millisecond. And we're now approaching the point where the next log storm is, I/O storm is going to hit us from the other database. But the thing to notice is we're not generating many outliers where the log times are either in a quarter of a second, there's a few, but we're not seeing the ones at 1 second. As a result, we're barely seeing a glitch at all. And in fact, what we're starting to see is transactions starting to degrade because the reads are taking longer. So at this point, we've started to smooth out all the performance problems associated with erratic log times. And if we actually look at the response time when we had erratic log times, you can see we, at each iteration, we're smoothing these things out over and over again. So in a second, we're going to come hit the next I/O storm, and you'll notice it's coming a lot smoother. And it's barely detectable at this point. The fact that there is an I/O storm taking place, but it's not impacting the system. There you can just see a tiny